गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, लास्ट क्लास वी आर डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द टेरेस्ट्रियल हैबिटेट। वी इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स वी आर डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द थ्री टाइप्स ऑफ हैबिटेट्स इन डिटेल। फर्स्ट वन इज द फ्रेश वाटर हैबिटेट, सेकंड वन इज द मरीन वाटर हैबिटेट एंड द थर्ड वन इज द टेरेस्ट्रियल हैबिटेट विद देयर कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स, with their examples, with their zones and the stratification of each habitat. Okay, then in this bit types of habitat, the last bit is the estuaries. Okay, we will discuss in very depth. So let's start. Estuaries ecosystem, or we can call it as estuaries. Okay, it is the place where fresh water and marine water meets. Okay, where the fresh water and the marine water mix with each other, we can call it as the estuarine or the estuaries ecosystem. We can see that where the fresh water habitat and the sea water is mixed together. I made this diagram, fresh water habitat and the sea water habitat, where sea water and the fresh water mixing together, where the two water, different types of water mix, the place is called as the estuaries ecosystem. Okay, then the concept of estuaries. An estuary is a semi enclosed areas. Semi enclosed means where the marine water habitat and the fresh water habitat meets, where fresh water from rivers meet ocean water, the two being mixed by the action of tides, where two tides, intertidal or the another tides, where mix, or the place where they meet, rivers and the ocean water, we can call it as the estuaries. Okay, the estuaries are highly productive ecosystem and characteristically are more productive than the adjacent sea or river. The degree of mixing of salt and fresh water depends on the morphology of the estuary basin. Okay, as we know that fresh water habitat having the low concentration of salt and the marine water habitat or the seas having a very high concentration of salt. The rate and volume of fresh water and the amount of tidal flow. In estuaries, the salty oceans mixes with a freshwater river, resulting in brackish water. The water is we can call it as the brackish water, where fresh water mixes with the marine water. Brackish water is somewhat salty but not as salty as the ocean, because there is a mixing of freshwater and the marine water, so that is not that much salty as compared to ocean. Brackish water has higher dissolved salts than a freshwater, that is about 0.5 to 3.5%. okay, an estuary may also be called as a bay, lagoon, sound or sludge. Okay, estuary may be called it as a bay, lagoon or a sludge. Estuary possess unique ecological features and biotic communities. Estuaries are most productive system of world. Example in the coast of Kerala, the best example where the system is very productive, example is the coast of Kerala. We can see that in Goa there is a Mandovi Zuari where the estuary is found, and in Kerala and in Adyar, Pulikat, in Godavari, Andhra Pradesh, in Chilka, Orissa, in the West Bengal. Then the next figure is where zone of diffusion, where sea water mixes with the fresh water, and zone of upward seepage, where two types of water, means fresh water and the sea water, mixes, the water is called as the brackish water. Then the types of estuaries. There are four types of estuaries based on how they created, okay, based on the tides. Very first is coastal plain estuaries. Coastal plain estuaries are created when sea level rise and fill in an existing river valley. Okay, how we can call it as coastal plain estuaries? Because the sea level rise and fill in an existing river valley. The Chesapeake Bay on the east coast of the United States is a coastal plain estuary. Example is the Chesapeake Bay in United States. Okay, the Chesapeake Bay was formed at end of the last ice age. Massive glaciers retreated, leaving a carved out landscape behind. Then next is the Atlantic Ocean, rushed to fill in the wide coastal plain around the Susquehanna River. Susquehanna River, creating a large estuary known as Rhea, a Drown Driver Mouth. The estuary is called as the Rhea, a Drown Driver Mouth. This is the Chesapeake Bay. Then next is tectonic estuaries. Tectonic estuaries are caused by the folding or faulting of land surfaces. These estuaries are found along major fault lines like the San Francisco Bay Area in California. This is the tectonic estuaries. We can see that the folding and the faulting of land surfaces, how it is fold, and we can call it as a tectonic. These tectonic estuaries are found in the California. Then next is bar built estuaries. Bar built estuaries form when a shallow lagoon or bay is protected from the ocean by a sandbar or barrier island. In the second figure, we see that the sand spit is there. So we can call it as a bar built estuary. Okay, it is found in the eastern seaboard and the Gulf Coast of North America are the example of bar estuaries. This is a diagrammatic representation, and this is the original photo of the bar built estuary where sand spit is occurred, so we can call it as the bar built estuaries. Then fourth is F Jords, or we can call it as Jords only. F Jords are U-shaped valleys. Okay, MCQ question may be asked on this F Jords. The shape of the F Jord valleys are U-shaped, formed by glacial action. Then next is F Jords are found in areas with long histories of glacier activity like Northern Europe, Alaska and Canada. Puget Sound is a series of F. Jords estuaries in the US state of Washington. The diagrammatic representation, we see that we observe that U-shaped F. Jord because of steep walls are occurred side to the F. Jord valleys. then the characteristics of estuaries. First one is physiochemical properties. Estuaries having large variation in several parameters and create stressful environment for organisms. This is the reason that large organisms are less in number in this area than smaller organisms. Smaller organisms are very much in number as compared to the large organisms. Okay, estuaries are dominated by soft muddy, means the combination of silt and clay substrate, and is rich in organic matter. When the strong current prevails, the substrate will be sand. Okay, where the strong current prevails, the substrate will be sand, because of where the current is where the water current is strong, the substrate will be a sand. If current is calm, means it is slow, or it is not that much strong, substrate is only fine silt will settle out. We can see that the wetland pool, salt flat, salt marsh, mangrove zone, intertidal mud flat, and the subtidal zone, where in the subtidal zone the upper surface having a fresh water, and the downward surface, we see that the upper surface and the downward means the benthic region having the high concentration of salt, and the in upper surface the fresh water is there, so where the salt concentration is less. Then next is the temperature. The water temperature in estuaries except fjords varies markedly because of their shallow depths and large surface area. In fjords, why it is temperature is not temperature is constant? Because we discussed about that fjords having U-shaped, so there is no fluctuation of temperature, or though there is no interchange, or there is no that much light penetration in the fjords. It heats up and cools down more rapidly under atmospheric condition, and the reason for this is freshwater input. What is the reason behind this? It heats up and cools down more rapidly. Okay, the surface water have the greatest temperature range, and the deeper water have lower temperature range. We are continuously discussing about that. The light penetration is less in the deeper portion of the water, and the higher in the upper portion of the water or the surface of water. So temperature is greatest in the upper surface and the lowest or deeper water having the low temperature range. Then next is wave action and its effect. All the variations, that is the salinity, the texture of substrate, temperature, organic matter, and available oxygen are controlled by wave action and currents. The wave action in estuary is very small. Okay, as a result, there is deposition of fine sediments and development of rooted plants. Because of very small action of wave, there is a development of the rooted plants. There is a less development of large plants in the estuaries. Then the estuarine current. When dense salty seawater flows into an estuary, it has an estuarine current. Okay, we can call it as the estuarine current. High tides can create estuarine currents. Salt water is heavier than fresh water. Why? Because there is a dense material or the salt material in the salt water, and as compared to salt water means it is a marine water as compared to the fresh water having a less salt concentration. So estuarine currents sink and move near the bottom of the estuary. Next is, when less dense fresh water from a river flows into the estuary, it has an anti-estuarine current. Okay, when less dense fresh water from rivers flows into the estuary, we can call it as a anti-estuarine current. Okay, anti-estuarine currents are strongest near the surface of the water. Heated by the sun, anti-estuarine currents are much warmer than estuarine current. Okay, because of where the surface, anti-estuarine currents are occurred on the surface of water, so it is much warmer than the estuarine current. So we can see that where the currents and the sea state, where geomorphology of estuary meets the fresh water flow and the tidal flow, where the anti-estuarine current has low temperature, and in case of estuarine current having the salt concentration is high, so that the temperature varies in the estuaries. Then next is current velocities and its effect. Current in estuaries are caused primarily by tidal action and river flow. Velocities up to several knots can occur. The highest velocities occur in middle, whereas in the bottom and the side bank. As compared to the bottom and the side bank, the velocity is highest in the middle portion of the estuary. The erosion and deposition in the estuaries are due to currents, which is a natural cycle. Okay, the erosion and the deposition in the estuaries are due to currents. Because of water flow, erosion is takes place and deposition is takes place in the another side. Okay, the first ice row in this I cited this in the first column or the first stage of this water current having the low velocity as compared to the second arrow. I showed that the first arrow where the velocity is low and the second arrow having the high velocity. It is the middle part of the estuarine current. Okay. However, in estuaries, deposition exceeds erosion. Yes, it is fact that the erosion because of water current and the deposition also from the water current. So in estuaries, deposition exceeds erosion. So there is a net accumulation of silt. During dry part of the year, water movement is severely reduced. Where dry part is of the year means there is no water flow, water movement is also less. So the flow of water is less, so the erosion is not takes place, also deposition is not takes place in that place. Then next is the turbidity. The water of estuaries is turbid because of the great number of particulates in suspension in the water. There is a suspension of particulates, so the turbidity is high. The turbidity is minimum near the mouth and the increase with distance inland. Here, the deposition or the suspension of particulates, the turbidity is less. And as compared to the deepest part, the turbidity is high. Thus, in turn decreases photosynthesis by phytoplankton and benthic plants. As I say that in the lower region or in the base of the estuary, there is a high turbidity because of the suspension of particulates. So there is no light penetration, so photosynthesis is not takes place in that place. So phytoplanktons and benthic plants reduced their productivity. The turbidity affects on the turbidity productivity of that estuary. I put it where I put these two images compared to first images having the high turbidity and the second image where as the low turbidity, where all living organisms are very well, and in first image living organisms having a risk, where sunlight penetration is high in the second image, where the trees are evergreen, and we here first image there is a high turbidity. Because of high turbidity, the plants are not very well developed, and there is a scarcity of water, or there is a very less amount of light penetration, so photosynthesis is not takes place in that place. The major ecological effect of turbidity is marked a decrease in the penetration of light. Because of that decreasing of penetration of light, the plants can't grow in that estuary. Then next is oxygen. Oxygen is also the most important factors in the estuary system. Since the solubility of oxygen in water decreases with increase in temperature and salinity, so the amount of oxygen varies with the parameters. Means where solubility in oxygen in the water decreases, so temperature increases and the salinity also increases. So depending upon the solubility, the temperature also rises and the salinity also increases. Then next is oxygen is severely depleted in the substrate. Because of less penetration of light, there is no photosynthesis occurred, so there is a less amount of oxygen. That's why oxygen is severely depleted in the substrate level. The high organic content and bacterial population of the sediments exerts a large oxygen demand on the water. Where oxygen is large amount, where the high organic content and the bacterial population is high, exerts a large oxygen demand on the water. So there is a scarcity of oxygen because of there is no photosynthesis, because of there is no light penetration in that place. Estuarine sediments are therefore anoxic below the first few centimeters unless they have large number of burrowing animals such as ghost shrimp, Callinacea, and hemichordate worm, balanoglossus, which by their activities oxygenate lower sediments layer. Okay, because of that animals oxygenate lower sediments layer. Then the salinity means the salt concentration. In estuaries, water level and salinity rise and fall with the tides, depending upon the tides, where the quantity of the freshwater habitat and the marine water habitat matters the level of salinity. Where the salt concentration is high, that place having the marinatory's quantity of marinatory is high, where the fresh water is high, the salinity is very less in that estuary. These features also rise and fall with the season. Seasonally, this feature is also rise and fall. During the rainy season, rivers may flood the estuary with fresh water and lowers the salinity. During the dry season, the outflow from rivers may slow to a trickle. The estuary shrinks and becomes much more saline. The next is, during the storm season, storm surge and other ocean waves may flood the estuary with salt water. Most estuaries, however, are protected from the oceans full of force of ocean waves and wind by geographical features such as reefs, you can call it as coral reefs, Iceland, mud and the sand. Then next is salinity and its effects of salinity. Salinity also varies with depth in the estuary. The salty seawater is more dense and stays on the bottom. As I say, in the upper portion salt concentration is less, in the lower portion salt concentration is high in the estuary. It flows in along the bottom in what is frequently known as a salt wedge. Meanwhile, the fresher, less dense water from the river flows out on the surface. It moves up the estuary on the rising tide, then recedes as the tide falls. This means that organisms that stay in one place are faced with dramatic fluctuations in salinity. In between the upper portion and the lower portion of the estuary, the organisms live in the middle place having the fluctuations of salinity. They are submerged under the salt wedge at high tide and under low salinity water at low tide. If the area has a diurnal tide, the organisms are subjected to two shifts in salinity every day. One as the tide moves upstream and a second as it retreats. In an estuary with semi-diurnal tides, salinity changes 4 times a day depending upon the temperature fluctuation, water current and the other aspects of estuary. See the two images where first image having the high salinity and the second image having the low salinity, where I show that where the crab is live there in between the 15% of the salinity to 35% salinity, and in second image where the crab is live in between 5% to the 15% salinity in that place, where seawater is less in the second image. And the first image I showed that where the seawater is high and the fresh water is less, so there is a high concentration of salinity. I showed that in second image fresh water is high and the seawater is less, so the salinity is also less in that estuary. Then the biota of estuarine ecosystem. It may be a flora or the fauna. The biota of estuaries is in turn regulated by degree of mixing. Mixing is both fresh water and the marine water habitat. Estuarine diversification is lower than river or marine because of tremendous variation in physical environment. there is a variation in the physical environment as in case of temperature, salinity, pressure and the water current. Major species are restricted to the estuarine situation, such as oyster and crabs, and those that come from sea, such as shrimp. Estuaries are nursery ground for vast number of marine animals, shrimps and crabs to fishes. Very few species are derived from freshwater, and only those that are capable of osmoregulation in the saltier environment. We discussed about that, the osmoregulation in freshwater habitat and the marine water habitat, where how it is called as the osmoregulation in case of the animals, where in freshwater habitat the salt concentration is high in the fluid of the that animal as compared to marine water habitat. In marine water habitat, the animals having less salt concentration in their fluid. So osmoregulation takes place in the freshwater habitat and the marine water habitat. So here the few species are derived from freshwater, so osmoregulation in the saltier environment takes place. This is the organisms live in the estuaries. Fishes. First one is microphytes and microalgae, phytoplanktons, zooplanktons, myofauna, macrofauna, fisheries, predation. It is the cycle takes place in the estuaries, depending upon the availability of light. The plants grow in case of high amount of light penetration. First one, the biota of the estuaries, the first one is the primary producers. Although not always evident, primary producers do flourish on mud flats. Mud flats means the bottom of estuaries that become exposed at low tide often form mud flats. A few seaweeds like the green algae, Enteromorpha, sea lettuce and some red algae grow on bits of shell. Bacteria and archaea are extremely abundant on mud flats. Bacteria are abundant on the mud flats. They decompose the huge amounts of organic matter brought in by rivers and tides. When the oxygen is used up by decay, some bacteria produce hydrogen sulfide, and they release hydrogen sulfide into the environment. This in turn is used by sulfur bacteria, chemosynthesis bacteria, that derive energy by breaking down sulfur compounds like hydrogen sulfide. Diatoms and bacteria, including photosynthetic bacteria, actually account for most of the primary production on mud flats. In fauna, the dominant animals on mud flats burrow in the sediments and are known as infauna. In case of other outfauna, means they are live in the outer portion of the estuaries. Burrowers like the fat innkeeper, means Eurechis capo, then polychaete, Hesperornis adventor, and a crab, a fish, and other guests. Mud flat inhabitants that feed on detritus. They are deposit feeders, animals feeding on organic matter that settles in the sediment. Settles in the sediment, we can call it the feeders, we can call it as the deposit feeders. Then next is suspension feeder. Animals including filter feeder that feed on particles suspended in water column. Many deposit feeders and some other members of the infauna are known as bioturbators because they move and mix sediment with burying and or digging. Bioturbation helps in the oxygenation of sediment, a most important role in the case of the typically anoxic sediments of estuaries. Then next is the meiofauna, the protozoans or the nematodes, and many other minute animals that composite meiofauna also thrive on detritus. The meiofauna are also known as the interstitial animals. They live in the middle of the estuaries. Middle part of the estuaries. The larger burrowing animals or infauna include many polychaetes. Most are deposit feeders. Other polychaetes are suspension feeders that filter water or extrude tentacles to collect the detritus that falls from the water column. Then next one is the epifauna. Very few mudflat animals can be classified as the epifauna. Those that either lie on the sediment surface or are attached to the surface as sessile form. In that, crabs, Mercicaneria, Maya araneria, Macoma ghost, mud snail, shrimps, and Yusa are some example of epifauna. Some of these are of considerable commercial importance. In this epifauna, some of species are considered as the commercial importance. For example, crabs, shrimps, and the mud snails. We can see the epifauna. The characteristic of epifauna is it is attached to the surface of the estuary. We can see there is a crab and the other animals, ghost shrimp, fat innkeeper, bent nosed small Macoma, and the worms and the mud snail and the moon snail. Okay, in the epifauna. Okay, then the predators. Most important predators in the mudflat community are fishes and birds. Fishes invade mudflats at high tide, whereas birds congregate at low tide to feed. The most significant predators on mudflats are wading shorebirds. These include willet, godwits, dowitches, and many species of plovers and sandpipers, such as curlews and phalaropes. They feed on polychaetes. Predators feed on the polychaetes, ghost shrimp, and other small crustaceans, clams, and the mud snails. So, here we end the unit first bit, types of habitat, and here we conclude that I completed our last bit of the types of habitat estuaries, and tomorrow we are going to start the ecological niche. Okay, thank you.